Hey everyone, welcome back to the channel. Today we are diving into something brand new and super exciting in .NET 9. That is hybrid caching. If you have ever had to manually combine memory caching and distributed caching, you know how tricky it can be to get them working together smoothly. Well, say goodbye to the hassle because .NET 9 has introduced this awesome hybrid caching feature that does it all for you. No more manual setup. Just plug it in and you get the best of both worlds. The speed of memory caching and the reliability of distributed caching all in just a single package. Maybe you'll be asking yourself, well, I know how to implement memory caching or distributed caching. So why do I need to know hybrid caching? Imagine this. You are just building a large-scale web application, like an e-commerce platform. And I believe that you want your users to have a super fast experience when they are browsing through products, isn't it? So here you want to implement caching. But at the same time, you need a reliability and scalability for the data stored in your cache. Now here is a challenge. If you are relying only on memory caching. Memory caching is incredibly fast since it stores data locally on the server. That's true. That is perfect for quick access to frequently used data, like product details or user search information. But there's a problem. Memory caching only works on the current server. So if you're running multiple instances of your server, or your server goes down, the cache is lost. Okay, let's say you want to implement distributed caching like Redis or SQL. This solves the problem of making the cache available across multiple servers because at the end, if you're implementing it on the Redis, you have a server sitting somewhere which will be giving you the data. If you're implementing it in the SQL, too, you have a table, structured table, which holds this data for you. It is reliable and scalable. But it is typically a little slower since the data had to travel over the network. So you see, when you implement both memory caching and now distributed caching together, it can make your system robust, isn't it? That is the reason why this introduction of this hybrid caching. So you know, in a high traffic application, you don't want to rely solely on one type of caching, either memory or distributed. That is where you need to implement this hybrid caching. This caching automatically combines the speed of in-memory caching and the persistence of distributed caching together. It stores the most frequently used data in the local memory for blazing fast access, while it also ensures that all the other servers or the instances share the same cache from a distributed source when they need it. Now let's see how we can implement this hybrid cache in our .NET 9 web API. So launch of Visual Studio 2022 or higher, and the current version of .NET 9 that I need to use here, it is, I think, 9. Let's check. So I can just have my command prompt, .NET version. So this gives you the current version, which is 9.0, having a release candidate of 1. etc. So you make sure you have .NET 9 installed. Now, if you want to install this, just update a Visual Studio and it's going to install this automatically. Let's create API project. So demo hybrid caching, that is my project name. Demo hybrid caching in web API. I have a location set already, so click on next. And the framework that we need to choose here is .NET 9 preview. So currently we are having on a preview. So you can select preview or .NET 9 in case it is no more in a preview mode. Now let's go to create this project. So once a project is created, all that we need to do here is to install this package. That is a hybrid package. Right click on dependencies and go to manage NuGet packages. And in here we need to install microsoft.extension.caching.hybrid. So let's get this package done from the browse tab. Okay, so we have this in here. You can see it is in the preview mode. So you must check this to get that. Now let's install this. So once this has done with the installation, we can go to our program and add the services for our memory caching and also distributed caching. So in here, let's add a memory cache first, which will be builder.services. The package for memory cache is opt-in, inbuilt, so we do not need to install any package. Okay, so we can go ahead and I say add, you can see I have memory cache, and now let's add the distributed cache. This time, we're going to be using the memory distributed cache. You can also implement Redis or SQL Server. So we have services.addDistributedMemoryCache. So let's add the hybrid cache service. So builder.services.addHybridCache. So for this, it has been there since. This is just the introduction of .NET 9, that is a hybrid cache. So this is what you want to focus most. This is going to manage both the memory cache and other distributed cache. Great. So now that we have this, let's go to the controller and implement it. This is quite simple. Implementing caching in .NET 9 is quite simple. So in our weather forecast, this is what we are going to do. We can just grab this. Let's say this is private task. This returns weather forecast. Let me say get cast. And this we are returning. Or we can even, since you're not having an await, we can call this. Okay, so in here, all that we can do here is to call this method and I'll return it, isn't it? Great. Before we do that, let's implement the iHybrid cache. We're going to be using primary constructor, so let's get rid of this. And in here, let's implement the interface of, I think this is part, the interface of iHybrid cache. Now, this should come from Microsoft.extension.caching. And we say this is hybrid cache. So now that we have the interface injected, let's grab this. And let's say we have our key. So let's have our string. And this is cache key. Let's say this is, let's give it any name at all. Well, I'm going to say this, weather data. Now we're going to say, we're going to cache this as data, and this equal to, we're going to have an await, and let's use a hybrid cache object, then dot, we have get or create, so this is going to get it or create it. In case it is not found and it calls a method to return the new data, it's going to cache it before it returns the response. So that's the reason why we have get or create async. Now this takes in some parameter that we need to specify. The first one is a cache key. The second part here, let me put this on the line. The second part here is going to be an option. That's an option. That's a function that we're going to make a call to in case the cache is not found. So here, this cache or this method takes in a token. So maybe if you want to pass in a cancellation token to stop this, you can do that. So here it's going to be an async. Then we say token And here we're going to make a call to this. Now, since it's going to be an async, it means we need to make this as task. So this should be task. And as soon as we have tasks here, it means we must introduce an awaiting, so I'm not making an actual service call. So you're going to say task.delay, and we're delaying this for about 5 seconds, which is 5,000 milliseconds. Okay, let's call this, and we need to issue an await. Then the last one here, we need to specify the token in case you have any token to pass it on. But we're going to say this is default since you're not having any token. You have the default one. So okay, see, get it. The first time that this got this call, this method is going to create it because it won't be found, right? And the next time, since it has created it already, it's going to get it. So we have get or create. Now after we have this there, that we can go ahead and return this. So return the data that we have. So just a single line, you can implement this hybrid cache. Okay, so let's see. It is async. It means this should be a task. As soon as you have this task, yes, we are good. The best thing is to make it return an option like that. I think action like this is very important. So we're returning okay, but I should take in iAction result, right? I can decide to remove this. So let's maintain or let's implement this iAction. iAction results. And we can get rid of all this. Okay. Now you're going to run this and check it out. So the first, I think we can use Postman to test this out. Now, when it's going to make the first call, is going to get this hit. So we can put breakpoint here. We're going to check if the first call, this method will be hit. The second call, no, it won't. Because by then, it might have cached it already. So it goes through the caching mechanism and ungrab it. Let's put breakpoint. Let's run this and check it out. All right, so when the app starts, you see we have a get method which got hit. Now let's continue on this. We have a cache key. This is the response. And let's see, since it is not found, this should give us null. So here we are going to make a call to this. And now let's get this. And it is returning this data. So let's wait for it. And like we see, we have it in here, isn't it? Now we're going to make, let's refresh this. It got hit. So we're making a call to a second time. Now continue on, and check it out. This should give us the data that we want, and we have it. We see we have it. So it won't call this because it has cached this already. Continue on. And we have it. And that is all for you today, folks. You've just learned, or you've just gone through how to implement this new hybrid caching feature in .NET 9. And as you can see, it is a total game changer when it comes to improving your app performance. By combining the speed of in-memory caching with the scalability of distributed caching, we get the best of both worlds without all the manual works. It's going to take you much time to implement it yourself, but well, thanks to this update, now we can implement this seamlessly and now move on with it. If you find this video helpful, don't forget to give it a thumbs up, subscribe for it if you haven't done so, and hit that bell icon so you never miss out any of my future .NET 9 tutorials. Thanks for watching, and I'll catch you up next time.